Okay, my name is Sally Menard, and Norm and I are delighted to welcome you here tonight for a very important Common Good event. And you are a beautiful sight, a room full of brilliant, engaged, informed activists. The best kind. So many of you in this room are people I've known for a long time. We've been in the trenches together in our continuing pursuit for the just society. Is there a person in the room? Each time the door opens, it's going to be like this. I'm the one who called in the water main break about 2 hours ago. I had a really hard time explaining the 311, what the street was like when it was bubbling up all over the place, brown water running down the Park Avenue. Unfortunately, I have to warn you that the water has been turned off on the whole street. So, drink lightly. Well, as they say, a lot of old friends here. We have worked together in a lot of campaigns to elect a lot of wonderful people. And what all of us have in common is our commitment to the mission of the Common Good, which is well-reasoned discussion, bipartisan discussion toward productive policy. And this evening's program is the latest example of Patricia Duff's very remarkable success in establishing a brand new public policy entity, which isn't easy. But she's convening people from all persuasions to talk about the critical issues with civility and with mutual respect, which is we can use a lot more of anywhere, obviously, you can mention. So there's probably no subject that needs attention, this kind of attention, more than the truly alarming trend away from democratic government around the world. And this evening, Garry Kasparov has assembled a high-powered group of speakers, high-chaired, high-powered, to address the subject. Before I turn you over to Patricia to introduce the program, I just have to tell you how thrilled I am to be in the same room with Mr. Kasparov. Garry is a hero to me. He's a dedicated and courageous advocate for freedom and democracy for many, many decades. So we owe you a great debt of gratitude.
Thank you.
Each of our speakers could be a whole evening by themselves, but to be sure there's time to hear from all of them, I'm going to surrender the microphone to Patricia. Come on. Thank you for coming.
Thank you, Sally, and thank you all for coming tonight. I wasn't sure how this would play, you know, what kind of a response we got. We put the invitation up with just Garry and Bret to begin with, and we had so many responses, it was crazy. And of course, they just kept rolling in. We had to stop at a certain juncture. So there are, I'm sure, a number of disappointed people who couldn't be here. But I want to welcome you tonight. I want to thank Sally, who is really, she's very self-effacing, but she's unbelievably effective. She started her own advertising business. She started, she really put women at the table at the Democratic Party by starting the Women's Leadership Forum. See, she's leaving the room. She's probably uncomfortable hearing praise because she's just amazing. And she has really helped build one of the most important landmarks, one of the newest and most interesting landmarks dedicated to Franklin Delano Roosevelt. It's beautiful and it's so important because it's about the four freedoms. So please thank our host, Sally Menard. We also have to thank her co-host, her husband, Norton Garfinkel, who is here, right here in the corner. He's an economist, he's an author, he's written books about economic policy, current and historical. He's a terrific writer and very important man in his own right. But for some of you who are new to the Common Good, I want to make sure that before you leave, at least you will know that the Common Good is about ideas. And ideas matter, especially today. But one of the greatest ideas, probably in human history, is something that created perhaps the greatest amount of freedom and opportunity in the world, and that is democracy. And our founding fathers were worried about democracy because it had failed throughout history at a certain juncture. It didn't last. It is something that we need to care for. we need to pay attention to. We need to be thoughtful about it. They gave us a way for all of us to be engaged. They insisted, they encouraged that we had to be educated. We had to be informed. And we have duties as citizens to do that. So I am very, very proud to have this extraordinary group of some of the most brilliant people, I think some of the most brilliant people in any room, to talk about threats to our democracy, not only here in the United States, but all over the world. And the person who has put this together, started this, was really extraordinary, of course, is Garry Kasparov. He is one of the, probably the greatest chess master in history. He has talked and written about the threats of Vladimir Putin, not only to Russia, but around the world. He has written about artificial intelligence, and now he puts his great reputation and thought and on our problems of democracy. So I want you to give a very warm, common good welcome to somebody who is not only a chess champion, but a champion for freedom and democracy. Garry Kasparov.
Thank you. This one? I have this one. Thank you, Patricia. I'm always telling my American audience that I was born and raised in the Deep South right next to Georgia. Which is factually correct. It was the Republic of Azerbaijan, Deep South of the Soviet Union, right next to the Republic of Georgia. It's just a reference to what has been said by Sally and Patricia, that I had some experience in facing and dealing with dictators. I spent the first 28 years of my life living in the Soviet Union, and I spent 13 years of my life before I had to leave Russia in 2013, living under rising dictatorship of Vladimir Putin. So I have quite a good instinct of recognizing dictatorship and autocrats even before they reveal their true colors. My first article about the threats coming from Vladimir Putin was dated January 4, 2001, in the Wall Street Journal. And for all these years, I've been saying that why Vladimir Putin was our problem, eventually it will be everybody's problem. I read enough books on history to know that when dictator faces mounting challenges at home, when economy is no longer serving for his purpose, he has to find new targets. He runs out of enemies inside the country, and he looks for them outside. And Vladimir Putin was no exception. It was just a matter of time where he could spend and overspend all the money that he and his cronies could earn or steal from high oil prices. It's probably about $2 trillion that they have been siphoned out of Russia and spent around the world, or located around the world. And he would have to embrace the most aggressive foreign policy. And as every dictator in the past, he hasn't crossed all the borders instantly. So we all think that democracy dies, you know, as a result of coup d'etat, of just, you know, no. Typically, when you look at history, it happens day by day, slowly. It's more like encroaching. It just, you know, you wake up one day and you find out that, yeah, maybe something is wrong with the freedom of speech. Couple of newspapers, you know, they cease to exist because they had commercial problems, because there were some kind of disputes that had to be resolved always in favor of a dictator and his cronies. And Vladimir Putin learned from history, so, and he knew that he needed, at the beginning, he needed friendship from the foreign leaders, and he did well. But again, as I've been warning for many years, the day would come when he would need enemies. So when you look at Russian TV, you'll find out that it's filled with anti-American propaganda, anti-Western propaganda. It's 24/7. And it's just not because they hate America or hate the West. At the end of the day, all these hundreds of billions, if not trillions of dollars, they are just being parked not in China or Venezuela or Iran, but in this country, in Europe. So in places where private ownership and means of productions and bank accounts are protected, which is quite an irony. This total destruction of the rule of law in Russia, and at the same time trying to protect their own capitals and their families and their fortunes in the free world. So wrote a book in 2015 that I called Winter is Coming. I hope that the book could start a debate about US foreign policy, because I could see many rising threats around the world. And I could see Vladimir Putin being like a spider in the center of this web. Yes, it's people say, oh, you are Russian, you're paranoid. Yes, I'm paranoid. I have a good reason to be paranoid. I'm also half Armenian, half Jewish. You know, there are more reasons to be paranoid about dictators. Yeah. So, and I could, you know, I could see, I could hear, I could see all the signs on the wall that is coming. And it's, and by the way, I could hear what they have been saying. It says in 2007, Vladimir Putin in Munich made a very, you know, it was a profound moment. He made a very convincing speech about his plans, talking about restoring the spheres of influence. The free world ignored it. You know, it's, he was, by the way, dictators, if you go back to Hitler, to Saddam Hussein, they, at certain point, they revealed their true plans. And then they said, wait, we said it, and you paid no attention. So next, you know, the West ignored it, and there was Republic of Georgia. He talked about Russian aspirations of restoring Great Russia, and, you know, Crimea was just on the map. And I think in 2008, in August, in another editorial in the Wall Street Journal, so I said, Russian enclave in Ukraine, enclaves, it's the next target. Not because I had a crystal ball, just because I looked at the map. No doubt that Vladimir Putin, just to strengthen his grip on power in Russia and to prove his invincibility to his cronies, because dictator is not threatened by the ballot, he's threatened by the bullet. And very often, or almost exclusively, the bullet comes from his back. So that's why every day he has to prove, not to his voters, he doesn't care about them, but to his own cronies and henchmen, that he's invincible. And what is the best way to prove that he's invincible? As to defy the strongest democracy in the world. And he did. So that's why, again, for me, it would be a matter of time when Vladimir Putin would use the machine that he built in Russia. From 2004 to 2005, we saw it, building troll factories, fake news industry. And eventually, you know, he would move it across the ocean. They have been slowly spreading their influence to Russian-speaking, you know, former Soviet republics, then to Eastern Europe, to Western Europe. America was just on the map. Again, surprisingly, nobody wanted to pay attention. So we know the result. We know the outcome. And I remember that in 2015, just, you know, just before my book was released, I was at Bill Maher's show, and I tried to raise the awareness about threat coming from Vladimir Putin. And Bill was very dismissive. And he ended up saying, wake me up when he takes over Poland. I almost jumped on my chair, saying, wait, it's the last time we heard it 8 years ago. It ended up with the greatest disaster in human history. Of course, after November 2016, Bill, you know, changed his mind, and he became a very steadfast critic of Vladimir Putin, harassing him in its almost every program. And I couldn't help teasing him on my Twitter, saying, "Ah, by the way, it seemed Vladimir Putin decided to skip over Poland and went straight to Wisconsin." So it's not surprising that after November 2016, a lot of people in this country thought about the future of this great democracy. And I had, you know, some of my friends, we also thought about it. And I have to confess that having all this experience facing dictators, fighting dictators, so and defending democracy, I never thought that the day would come when I have to share my experience with my American friends. Not just for the sake of history, but for the very practical purposes of defending democracy in this country. So the idea of organization that we named RDI, Renew Democracy Initiative, was to bring together so intellectual firepower from right and the left and start talking about values, something that made this country great and something that helped free world to succeed and to thrive. We believe that, you know, many of these values, this not yet been abandoned, but they've been ignored. And even the greatest mechanisms, the institutions of democracy that have been built in this country, you know, over 200 years, they're getting rusty. And it's very important to find so the right framework to make them adjustable to the modern challenges of the 21st century. So we got this group, we came up with a manifesto that referred to the threats coming to the free world from both sides, from far right attacking liberal democracy and from far left attacking market economy. And to our surprise, a lot of people, yeah, just the number of people who signed it, yes, it's exceeded our expectations. And again, they came from both right and left, from Larry Tribe to Bill Kristol, from Stephen Fry to Jose Maria Aznar internationally, about 200 prominent signatories, and then there are many more people who decided to sign it, and then we thought, why not to come up with a book that you have, you know, Fight for Liberty. Of course, the publisher added Defending Democracy in the Age of Trump. We agree with that, but it was not our main purpose, because for us, Trump is more like a symptom. There were so many things that happened that made Trump almost inevitable. So that's why we should not, you know, concentrate on the person, which again, it's important to make sure he will not be reelected, but it's not just about him. It's about actually recovering the spirit of democracy and rebuilding the institutions that already have been greatly greatly damaged. So we have this book, and we are, you know, we hope that it will help people to, especially young generation, to recognize that it's, you know, we live in a great country, and a free world has no alternatives. Because what makes me really almost feel sick when I hear young teenagers or college graduates talking about China, for instance, about, you know, other ways of doing business and other ways of being successful. And I understand that, you know, in the modern world, online, in this virtual reality, you can be enticed by Chinese success. But at the end of the day, if you look, you know, at the history of mankind, only free people could make this world great and could move us into the bright future. So, having said that, so I'd like just to introduce one by one, no particular order. So, four of my colleagues, exceptional individuals who are working with me. Just to build this I don't know how you call it, you know, movement. Okay, this movement. And then let's start with Bret Stephens. So I call him, okay, joking, a political refugee from the Wall Street Journal. So okay, Bret.
Well, thank you so much. Is this on? Hold on.
I think it's there. Right. This one, just.
Well, Garry, thank you so much. Thank you for coming out this evening. I just want to say.
Oh.
It works.
It works also.
There we go.
No.
Okay. I mean, I just want to say what an honor it is to be here, and to thank Patricia for wherever she is. I can't see her.
Here.
For putting it together. I just want to make a few brief remarks. I'm probably one of the younger people in the room, and I'm going to scandalize, I suspect, a great many of you by telling you that I graduated from high school in 1991. Which has turned out to be an interesting year in which to become an adult, because 1991 was, of course, the year in which the Soviet Union finally collapsed. So the world that I entered in my, you know, at least legal maturity, was a world that was confident that the future was democratic, was liberal, was market-oriented, was going to be increasingly peaceful, was going to be increasingly rational. Those were our expectations coming of age in the late 1990s. And the touchstone events of my youth, America's lightning victory in the Gulf War, and that clear evidence of our military supremacy, the collapse, or the breaching, I should say, of the Berlin Wall a couple of years earlier, and the evidence of the superiority of free societies over dictatorships, the beginning of the boom years of the 1990s, and that incredible optimism about what market economies could achieve if they were just allowed to operate according to their own devices. So those were the assumptions I brought with me to a large extent, or at least that my generation brought with it as we came of age. I happened, somewhat by accident, to have a father who, because of his own background, was obsessed with the ideological, or I should say the intellectual literature of the Cold War, and even before that, of the totalitarian era. And so as I was coming of age, and then also in the 1990s, Sort of in a way out of an intellectual interest, I found myself reading people like Hannah Arendt, Czesław Miłosz, the great Polish poet and dissident, Arthur Kessler, of course, author of Darkness at Noon. A great deal of this rich literature that revolved around the subject of totalitarianism, which of course we thought we had put behind us. And so this for me, this interest was a kind of an antiquarian interest. Like, wasn't it strange that entire societies gave themselves over to these lunatic manias and these aggressive despotisms that controlled not only how they could behave, but also could control how they would think? And most interesting to me, when it came to reading that literature, well, it wasn't so much that these regimes operated through coercion, through force, but they found ways in which to persuade those who were coerced that the system they were offering was in some ways a superior system. After all the totalitarian regimes had, to borrow a phrase, their own willing executioners and their own willing followers. So how did Homo Sovieticus come into being? How did these creatures of the totalitarian age come into being? So at any rate, I had read all of this stuff, and I thought, well, this is sort of interesting, you know. But you know, it's kind of it's looking at the past. Well, fast forward to my 10th or 11th year as a columnist at the Wall Street Journal. And suddenly, a number of events presented themselves as largely as bolts from the blue. The rise of someone like Jeremy Corbyn as head of the Labour Party, the decision by the British to go for Brexit, the rise of populist movements all over Europe, some of which seemed to make, you know, understandable in a particular context, but as you saw it unfold in Poland, Hungary, the Czech Republic and elsewhere, you began to see a pattern. And then, of course, in this country, to my great dismay, the capture of a party I had always associated with, the Republican Party, by a person that I thought was utterly not just disreputable, but dangerous, and who, whether wittingly or not, was mouthing the sorts of things that had their echoes and their genesis in the politics and ideologies of the 1920s and 1930s. America First has a very distinctive pedigree that comes to us from that era. The idea that the press would be the enemy of the American people also has its distinctive pedigree, not from the 20s, but from the teens, of course, from Vladimir Lenin. And then most interesting for me was the way in which so many of my colleagues on the right found ways to rationalize behavior that you would think, if they were just operating commonsensically, would be inexcusable. And I don't just mean the crassness, I mean the willingness to adopt policies that, had they been practiced by a Democrat, would have, you know, supposedly been abhorrent. So all of a sudden, in 2016, all of this literature that I had gone through came vividly to life, and I realized that it wasn't an antiquarian interest, but that this was the experience that we were going through. Why then did I feel so compelled to join forces with Garry to be a part of this book? One of the things that I think I learned is that while I had been fortunate, thanks to my father, to have a deep education in civics, in the constitution of free societies, and in the unique psychological mechanisms by which populism and authoritarianism operate, very few of my people of my generation, and certainly hardly anyone from the generation that came after me, shared that. So they were, in a sense, people who had grown up uninoculated, intellectually speaking, from these sorts of temptations, the temptation of populism, the temptation of authoritarianism, and even the temptation of totalitarianism. So it seemed to me not only relevant, but urgent, that we start talking in a serious way about why is it that free societies and the institutions of those societies are relevant, are necessary, are good for us, and are better than some of the alternatives being presented, whether it's on an economic question like protectionism, or it's on a civil liberties question like the importance of maintaining a free press and respecting the institutions of the press. That then ended up being part of, you know, part of what this book was about. I'll just make one final point. My chapter in the book is about the question of values and interests in foreign policy. And I want you to read the books, and I want you especially to read my chapter because it's so good.
Have, because it's the last one. They have to read the book.
You have to read the book to get to the last part, one. Yes. Right? It's like a seduction, right? It's the last, anyway. I'm concerned about the question of interests and values, and we're living through a period in which there's a kind of brute transactionalism to the new American foreign policy. I think you can't have a better example of that than Mike Pompeo's op-ed in the Wall Street Journal just yesterday or the day before, explaining why the death of Jamal Khashoggi is essentially insignificant in the context of our beautiful relationship with our dear friends, the Saudis, who have always had nothing but our best interests at heart. But that kind of transactionalism is an interest-based view of the world. And when I think of what makes America genuinely exceptional, one of the things that strikes me is that throughout history, most great powers have defined their values according to their interests. And by that I mean, you know, Rome, its interest was conquest, its values were courage, loyalty, honor, all of the things that went into making effective legions capable of conquering the known world. The United States, at least at our best, we've operated on a very different principle, which is we have asked ourselves what our values are, and then found our interests being defined accordingly. And I'll just offer you one final thought on this point, since I began with my teenage years. In 1948, Harry Truman took the extraordinary decision, against the advice of many of his generals, to relieve the siege, the blockade of West Berlin. That is to say, to come to the defense of a little enclave of freedom that, from a military point of view, was indefensible. That there was no way any American or French or British garrison was going to be able to defend West Berlin against the many divisions that Stalin had surrounded it with. But as a matter of American honor, as a matter of belief that we had a duty to this enclave, he ordered the airlift of Berlin. And of course, people know that the airlift worked, and you know, it was a great example of American logistics. But think about it just one more second. It was thanks to that airlift that our enemy in two great wars understood that there was no more benevolent a power than the United States. And instead of having a bellicose and hostile Germany, we developed this great ally, so great that I'm married to one of its citizens, this great ally at the heart of Europe. A year later, NATO came into being, not least because countries could understand that if America would risk everything for the sake of West Berlin, it would risk something for larger things like France, Norway, Belgium, and so on. And then 41 years later, in 1989, without a shot being fired or a life being lost, we won the greatest conflict of the second half of the 20th century. Why? Because the people of East Berlin only needed to look over the wall to understand that all of the communist propaganda was a lie, that freedom was in every respect superior to tyranny, and the only thing they needed to do was find a way to breach that wall, to end and force the collapse of that entire edifice of tyranny. So I just want to leave that thought with you, that it turns out that when you define your interests according to your values, you will ultimately realize your deepest and your best interests, even if it sometimes takes several decades for that to happen. And I hope we can do it again. And I'm going to stop there.
Thank you. Thank you, Bret. It's great story, and so we all hope that the evil will be buried forever under the rubble of the Berlin Wall. But you know, the moment we lose our complacency, it sprouts out. And just I thought about an interesting trivia. You mentioned 1948. There were three American presidents that each of them said four words that defined the history and the fate of Germany. Harry Truman, "We shall stay," period. JFK, "Ich bin ein Berliner." Ronald Reagan, "Tear down this wall." So, okay. I hope we'll find four more words, actually, to continue this great tradition. And now, since we talked about the law and the constitution, so we have to move to one of the best constitutional lawyers in this country, Philip Bobbitt. Philip, take a seat.
And now, the academic. During the many years in which I have taught the U.S. Constitution, I have become increasingly mindful of its explicit and implicit guarantees of the rights of conscience, and more importantly, of its design, in which the exercise of the individual conscience is made an essential part of governing, whether on juries, or in polling booths, or in the councils of state. This is the watermark of the unique American constitutional ethos. At least so thought the founding generation. Yet it seems that this design must be vindicated by each new generation, often facing novel threats to our liberties that may not have been entirely anticipated by the framers. It hasn't been a good couple of years for the informal norms that support the American constitutional ethos. The president who vows to incarcerate his political opponents, who as a candidate refused to commit to accepting the verdict of the election, whose staff attempted to conspire with a hostile foreign power in cyber burglaries and cyber propaganda campaigns, and who encourages violence against the press, such a man is the embodiment of a troubling historical departure. A president who asserts the power to pardon himself, something that never occurred to the framers. A man who attempts to coerce the head of the FBI to shelve an investigation into his aides, who exhorts naval officers to commit themselves to partisan declarations, who does not shrink from tampering with witnesses to events in which he has been implicated, who demeans judges on the basis of their ethnicity or the presidents who nominated them, who invents and persists in telling the now proven lie that his predecessor was wiretapping him, who engages in a steady campaign to delegitimate the electoral process by falsely claiming that millions of votes have been stolen, and who uses the sacred office of the presidency to enrich himself and his family. Such a person strikes, however haphazardly, at constitutional norms that are not codified, but dwell in the consciences of the men who've held that office, and the woman who should have. Of course, the president is not the only figure on the stage who seems heedless of those norms that are meant to protect our liberties. Incivility in our politics, the petty harassment of officials, the intolerance of the very expression of ideas with which we disagree, and the cultivation, rather than the overcoming, of recovered memories of historic shame are projects on which the president does not have a monopoly. But these are also threats as to which we must be very vigilant. Moreover, the weakening of our constitutional institutions and of our confidence in them will have profound consequences for world order, the subject of my chapter in the book we present tonight. The growing lack of national cohesion and self-confidence will excite external threats and compel us to abandon historic structures that have brought us safety and prosperity. Threats, however, need not necessarily bring catastrophe. As Archibald MacLeish once put it, they may be the grit with which the oyster mends his shell. The Constitution, written and unwritten, is constructed to enable us to carry out the project of the Declaration of Independence. The Declaration establishes a liberal ethos of tolerance, social mobility based on talent and effort, a pluralist society with power derived from consent. It is the Constitution that provides a mechanism for determining our futures, how and whether we will realize this vision, by putting decisions in our hands. New threats to that vision, and inherited ones, are actually the grist for that mechanism. This may be what Barack Obama had in mind when he spoke at the 50th anniversary of the Selma March. Standing before the Pettus Bridge, he asked, "What greater form of patriotism is there than the belief that America is not yet finished, that we are strong enough to be self-critical, that each successive generation can look upon our imperfections and decide that it is in our power to remake this nation to more closely align with our highest ideals?" Of course, this means it is also in our power to degrade these ideals. I take it that the purpose of this book is to prevent that.
Thank you. Thank you, Philip. And of course, no successful campaign today could move forward without press. So now, next, it's one of the top CNN anchormen, John Avlon. It's working?
It is working.
Okay, you know better. Yes.
It's working, correct? Yeah.
Yes.
It's an honor to be here. Patricia, thank you. Common good, because I think common good is really what this book is all about. I mean, the diverse voices that have been brought together. Because we feel a real urgency, the fight for liberty, which is fundamental to our nation since the founding, but also the defense of liberal democracy. That is a project that is both domestic and foreign, and it's urgent right now. Because liberal democracy, as Brent said, we're the same age, you know, seem descendant, it is, if not in retreat, it is in need of retrenchment. Ethno-nationalism is on the rise. The promise of wealth without liberty and autocracy. These are real dangers, alternative ways of life, so we have something worth fighting for in America, but we cannot take it for granted. We also can't say we weren't warned. I wrote a chapter on political tribalism in this book, but earlier I wrote a book on George Washington's farewell address. And Washington's farewell address explicitly warned his friends and fellow citizens, and that's who he addressed it to in the newspaper in which it was published, about the forces he feared could destroy our democratic republic, rooted in lessons of life and lessons of history. And chief among them were what we would call hyperpartisanship, excessive debt, and foreign wars and foreign influence in our domestic debates. So we're 3 for 3 there, folks. And these are not distant concerns. It's not just that Washington was not a member of a political party as a matter of principle. It was that looking at the lessons that led to the English Civil War, looking at the decline of ancient Greece and Rome, hyperpartisanship was a real urgent danger because it could create a deadlocked democracy where special interests were blocking the national interests. That would create a dysfunctional government, and that would lead to a frustrated citizenry, which would then open the door to a demagogue with authoritarian ambitions. That had been the pattern throughout history. And that was something worth anticipating and setting up a system of government to check and balance that at every step of the way. Excessive debt, Hamilton had ghostwritten the speech, had always been a force that had toppled empires in the past. And we have grown heedless about that as one party which campaigned on it abandoned its once moral authority on the subject. And then, of course, foreign wars and foreign influence in our elections. Well, we all see now that Vladimir Putin didn't write that playbook by himself. That was something that is been an issue throughout history. But it's interesting, when Washington tried to lay down the marker of values, of pillars of liberty that could be antidotes to those larger forces, they were fundamental American values about focusing on national unity rather than regional or partisan divides, of the virtue and strength of political moderation and democracy, not being a position of weakness, but a position of wisdom and strength. The importance of public education, the importance of religion and morality and virtue, the importance of civic education. All of these are virtues that we are supposed to be inculcating and handing down, and we've done a fairly poor job of it. But Washington had a fascinating phrase for one of the dangers he anticipated, which was pretend patriots. And he used that phrase to describe people who would try to divide Americans against one another by proclaiming that they were more American than anybody else. It's an early danger even then for us to be wary of. It's that constant impulse to try to divide and conquer, which has always been the demagogue's calling card throughout history, us against them. And of course, the American experiment, the American mission, is the exact opposite, e pluribus unum, out of many one. We have always been, however imperfectly, a diverse liberal democracy from our earliest days. We don't recognize it as such because the idea of French and Germans and English living side by side is not so remarkable. But it was then, because those folks had been killing each other on the continent for a long time. And so it's been a process of becoming imperfect people, fighting to form a more perfect union. But we have been historically a great force for good. And that's why we are worth the fighting for. And so we are here at a moment we're kind of unaccustomed to. We have been through hard times before. This is not the worst time we've been through as a nation, not by a long shot. But we need to be incredibly vigilant about defending our liberty and defending our diverse liberal democracy, because it is differentiating on the world stage. We are the only nation, the first nation in the world, founded upon an idea and an ideal, not a tribal identity. And so when those tribal forces start to infiltrate our politics, we need to beware. When that negative partisanship that we see today, where people start saying, well, I really know I'm against them, that perception of them, and that starts to animate and provide a purpose in their lives, that's a dangerous thing. That's a truly dangerous thing that we need to keep an eye on. And it's not an accident that I think when the Russians and other foreign actors start meddling in our election via social media and disinformation campaigns, they intentionally focus on the fissures created by political tribalism and identity politics. Their goal was really to set Americans against one another, to sow the seeds of confusion, to sow the seeds of division. Look at what they did. They're taking out ads that are in favor of Bernie Sanders as well as Donald Trump. I mean, consistently, that is their goal. They're identifying identity politics as a great source of weakness for our republic. And if nothing else, that's a reason for us to stand up and try to counteract it with a real force. A movement to do it across partisan lines, based on that very basic American idea of e pluribus unum, that there was more that unites us than divides us as Americans. And that's what I think is so hopeful about this book and the group that's been put together. And it's really a message that we can't have the luxury to ignore anymore. We really do need to build a broader movement. I think, frankly, it's going to take building an alternative architecture. It's going to take a political architecture that starts thinking about principles rather than partisan interests. I think it's going to take building think tanks that start pointing out that, guess what, around 70% of the American people agree on underlying policy ideas. We've been artificially divided. In fact, if you look at American politics throughout our history, most of the great debates haven't actually been representative between left, right, liberal, conservative. In the 1920s, the original progressive era, Earl Warren, Republican governor of California, lest we forget, used to say the real divisions of our society aren't between left and right, they're between radicals, reactionaries, and reformers. I think that's instinctively true, and if you look at each stage and challenge in our history, I think it is true. So this is about saying that reformers need to plant a flag, that we are a distinct tradition that represents our country's best traditions, and that we need to start advancing these ideals unapologetically, and there's a civic education component to all of this as well, as Bret said. We can't take that for granted. But if we start building this alternative architecture, if we start really planting a flag and holding our heads up high and uniting across all our interesting differences, then I think we're engaged in incredibly important and noble work that really is rooted in the Founding Fathers' vision, e pluribus unum. And it is worth remembering or worth meditating upon the simple fact that e pluribus unum is the exact opposite of us against them. That's the danger of tribalism, and that's the opportunity. So thank you.
So many times said George Washington has been mentioned by John. So I thought that would be the most appropriate moment to introduce our next speaker. So my friend Ian Kahn spent 4 years playing George Washington in the Netflix series term, Washington Spies. Sometimes I think he believes he's a reincarnation of George Washington. So, when the Republic is in grave danger, it's time to call for a general.
Thank you, Gary. Thank you, Patricia. And thank you to the Common Good. What a wonderful organization. you have here, as I was reading the literature, talking about the fragility of our democracy and how back when the founders were doing their work, they were aware of this great experiment. I will say this, having played General George Washington for 4 years, I spent every day asking myself one question, which was, yes, what would General Washington do? And my hope, my goal, my idea about this next time in our lives is that we ask all of us, what would George Washington be doing in this moment? One thing I learned, you know, I know growing up, I always looked at General Washington. I call him General Washington because that is how he wished to be spoken of. Even when he became the president, he was always first the general. But when I looked at him, I always thought of him as this sort of stodgy old man, you know, sort of grumpy, standing there. But the truth was, he was an incredibly charismatic man. He built this nation. Without him, we wouldn't have a country at all. And one of the things that I was constantly aware of is how fortunate we were to have this nation. Because if we look back to this Revolutionary War, really, it was England, which was the greatest fighting force in the history of the world at that time, going up against a ragtag bunch of men and women who were sort of throwing a uniform on and fighting for liberty. There were so many times over the course of this war where we were going to lose. They didn't have a chance. It was the New York Yankees versus a college baseball team. And what ended up happening? We found our way. Providence. General Washington often spoke of providence and the importance of that belief. Now here we are in this great experiment of liberal democracy. Well, sometimes experiments go wrong. Thomas Edison, how many times did he go for a light bulb? How many things blew up in his face? Well, Thomas Edison, things blew up in his face. Right now, our liberal democracy, our experiment, is struggling. Is a bit on fire. And what we need is good people like this, the Common Good, Renewed Democracy Initiative, to come together, a new generation of founding mothers and founding fathers. It's in some way a wonderful opportunity for us, because things are being burned down to the ground, all around us. Now, we had some, depending on your political persuasion, we've had some good news over the course of the last month. The House has returned, there's a check, there's a balance. But as Garry says, and Garry is, I'm very grateful to be on Garry Kasparov's team, one of the great minds alive, who is dedicating his time, his life, to saving liberal democracies around the world. We're first here in America. Why? Because America first. We save it here, we can save it across the world. It's our opportunity now, the common good. Renew Democracy Initiative. We must all work together. It's in our hands now. I'm very grateful to be here with you all. Thank you.
Thank you, Ian. Okay, now we move to Q&A, and I don't know how we handle it, but let's just first come first serve. We have enough mics here.
Well, the one thing that I think is missing here is anyone on the Republican side speaking, because I have heard, well, from you particularly, a whole list of crimes of the current president has committed, none of which he's been convicted of yet, and some of them which he has not done. So there's no counterbalancing here, and there's not a person in this room that doesn't believe in the broad picture that we're talking about here. We should not be so partisan. We should do the right things. But that's not what's happening in our fractured democracy. And I'm disappointed that in a group that's supposed to be about free ideas, nonpartisan ideas, that this could have almost been a Democratic rally with top intellectuals talking intelligently instead of screaming profanities, which we've seen in both parties.
We have this elderly one. Okay, your first one. that view.
I'm a Democrat, and I don't apologize for it. I don't remember uttering any profanities.
You did not.
But I certainly don't think that the accusations I made are without foundation. I don't think, but correct me if I'm wrong, that the people I'm speaking with are Democrats.
Oh, yeah.
In fact, I'm quite surprised to be to find myself with so many Republicans. My idea of a great country is FDR and LBJ, and I very much doubt that most of my compatriots in this movement would agree with that. In fact, it's easy for me to criticize what's happening in this country and in the White House. I've worked in the White House for Republicans as well as Democrats. It's, I think, much braver and takes real courage for the Republicans you're talking about to stand up against what's happened in this country and this party. Nobody cares about that. What you'd expect from me. But these guys are getting trolls, they get death threats, they get obscene messages on their machines. And that's the Republican Party nowadays. Well, then I'm glad I'm a Democrat.
Can I just... okay, go ahead, yes.
It's weird having been the deputy editorial page editor of the Wall Street Journal for 8 years, the foreign affairs columnist of the Wall Street Journal for 11 years, a member of the editorial board of the Wall Street Journal for 14 years, to be accused of being a liberal Democrat. You know, I've noticed since I joined the Times that there are two kinds of people in the world. There are people who don't read the Times and think I'm a liberal, and then there are people who read the Times and know the truth. And that means that when, during the Kavanaugh nomination, I supported his nomination, I supported the tax cuts, I supported getting out of the Iran deal, I supported the move of the U.S. Embassy to Jerusalem. I'm doing this to scandalize the liberals here. Okay?
It's working.
That is the intention, all right? Because I'm not simply a sort of former conservative who's now a sort of a vanilla centrist. I have stuck to my guns. But here's what matters to me. That the Republican Party that I used to know and its leaders understood that even a liberal-leaning press was essential to the well-functioning of democracy. The Republican leaders I admire always understood that free trade is as essential to free enterprise as lower taxes and common sense regulation. The Republican leaders that I know understand that you do not attack the independence of the judiciary, much less try to divide the judiciary between the Obama judges and the Trump judges and so on. The Republican leaders I know understood that a foreign policy of engagement, internationalism, and defending freedom on its farther frontier, whether it's at the demilitarized zone in Korea or at Checkpoint Charlie in West Berlin, was a far better alternative than the kind of isolationism that had been championed by radical Democrats like George McGovern and the Bring America Home crowd of the early 1970s. And I suspect you know exactly what I'm talking about. So what I'm trying to do is say, what I'm interested in defending isn't this or that policy or how you felt about Brett Kavanaugh. I'm trying to defend, both in the United States and abroad, foundational ideas about, and I mean this in the old-fashioned sense, liberal democracy, individual rights, and democratic processes that used to be a common ground for every conservative and every liberal that I know. And so what I am doing here isn't trying to sort of remake myself into David Brooks with better teeth. sorry, David.
I'm trying to say that any real conservative is not a populist, is not a bigot, understands the value of immigration to this country, and understands that our strength ought to be defined by a set of values that unite us rather than divide us. And I'll stop there.
I can add that the president of RDI, Renewed Democracy Initiative, is Max Boot, another lifetime Republican who left the party after November 2016 elections. And many of the founding members of RDI, they're also lifetime Republicans who believe in these ideas that Bret has described so vividly. But they also understand that it's not time to actually continue these arguments about important political issues when the foundation of the Republic is in jeopardy. Yeah, and I would love to have Republicans that are willing to debate, you know, current Republicans. Unfortunately, they are busy, you know, defending the man who is carrying their banner these days. And I remember as one of my most popular tweets just at the very beginning of this very unfortunate era was, it's the house is on fire, Trump is running around with the box of matches, and Republicans wants to find out who called the fire department.
Let me just to round it out. I worked for Rudy Giuliani for 7 years. He used to be a great writer. I was proud to do it. I think Rudy and Bloomberg helped save New York City. So I think if you read the book, you'll actually find probably the better hit on its on our folks is that it leans center right. For sure.
Okay. We have many questions over there. Okay.
There's only with the
yeah.
I just wanted to ask your opinion. I think one of the most disturbing things about the last midterm elections was the lack of voting by the younger generation. And I know you mentioned earlier most of the people in this room are probably older than you. What are your suggestions to get more people in the 18 to 35 populace more involved in becoming more involved in the democracy, whether Republican or Democrat?
You want to get us, just let's spread out.
Sure, so questions about getting young folks to vote. Look, we just had an election in which we had record turnout for a midterm election, nearly 50%, and record youth turnout. That's the silver lining, I think, to the civic stress test we're coming under. But I do think it's a bigger problem. I mean, it's not simply about the short-termism that we too often depend on to solve problems in this country itself as a problem. And we can't wait for a crisis to unite. And I think part of it is about more of an emphasis needs to be paid on civic education. We have really fallen short on this as a country. That has helped contribute to our fragmentation. It has led to a degree of laziness when it comes to civic responsibility and civic discipline. It has led to a certain moral relativism about an American system and liberal democracy versus other systems. Whereas, I mean, there's one terrifying poll that says only 35% of millennials say it's very important to live in a democracy. We need to do a better job about teaching civic education and American history and the responsibilities that come in with living in a free society. All those things would help. We have a success story come off the last election, but that also should not lull us into a sense of complacency. We need to make politics and civic engagement, that's the price of entry in a liberal democracy. It depends on vigorous citizenship, but we need to do a better job teaching it early on. And I think, frankly, it's not going to come from government. It's going to come from patriotic philanthropy at first. We need
more. Yeah, I just remember when these people were complaining about 80,000 votes. That's basically decided the elections in three battleground states. I said that we have to concentrate now on 90 million people who didn't vote.
Yeah.
Oh wow! How many hands? So we just will start moving. You know, from my right to the left. Okay.
Get away, guess.
Maybe one answer per question.
Yeah. One answer.
Just a follow-up to that, what I think is really poignant about how we don't have civic education in our country. But we also have a lot of adults who are beyond here, and they're out where they are, who don't have any interest in being informed or learning about what it really takes. And how do we reach a population of people, and young people understand that they really, beyond, you know, the civic education part of it, how do we really get people who are not engaged really understood that the politics are local, and also people need to guide their own communities? And
do you want to answer? Who wants to answer?
Philanthropy, I understand, you know, organizations represent us, organizations like that are out there doing the battle.
Who wants to answer?
Our adult population who has no interest.
You want to? No? Go ahead, John. Okay.
Well, I don't. Brett, why don't you take this guy?
Okay, sure.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. Brett.
Look, is this on?
For many years, there was a school in political science that argued that when voters don't vote, they were being rational. Which is to say that, you know, life was fine. And whether your senator is, you know, your congressman is Chris Shays or the other guy or what, you know, whatever it is, it doesn't make that much of a difference because the institutions in which you live and the life you live that is so predictable that the differences between this set of characters or the other is it doesn't affect you. And that was, in a sense, the blessing of the United States for many years, that people could actually afford to be indifferent to politics in a way that is simply impossible if you're, say, a Colombian citizen and there's a question about what are you going to do about the FARC, or you're a British citizen with a foreign-born spouse and there's a question about Brexit. Questions become much more urgent. So, you know, if there's a silver lining, I think, to our politics today is that it has awakened people who had previously been asleep to the notion that politics really does matter, and that these questions about not just policy making but also political culture are vital to the lives we lead. Now, that can only happen, though, I think, when you only break through if there is some effort to put before normal, ordinary people a set of ideas and speakers and op-eds and books and whatever that espouse, you know, the tenets of the best tenets of liberal democracy. I mean, demagoguery was a category that we thought existed only in Argentina, right, or you know, sundry countries like that. And now we're discovering it's a category that's alive and well here in the United States. And the challenge of the demagogue is that the demagogue, and we write about this in the book, the demagogue is always adept, is not a liar. He is adept at picking up on the half-truth and then coming out with the terrible solution. Look, you know, and I say this as a conservative, there is a suffocating problem of political correctness in this country. Right? And I think a lot of people who voted for Trump said, this is a guy who just doesn't give a hoot. Right? And he'll say whatever he wants to say, and that's good because I'm so sick of feeling like, oh, I can't say this and I can't say that, and this thought is prohibited, and so forth and so on. And I agree that there is a real problem with political correctness. I mean, you just have to sort of read the news from our college campuses to say, gee, you know, this is not liberalism. This is a kind of liberal fascism, to borrow a phrase. But the answer to that is not, well, you know, political correctness is a problem, therefore what we need is a louder espousal of bigotry. We need to understand why the concept of free speech, even if there are problems with it, is a valuable one. You know, and then you come to the old line in Jefferson's first inaugural address. Error of opinion may be tolerated where reason is left free to combat it. And that requires civic education. And then people start to say, oh, that is what I actually believe. And what we're trying to do is to, when people read this book, we want people to say, that's what I really believe, not that other stuff. That's what matters here.
Here and then, one second, first here.
Hi. So my question is, I mean, I want to go back to the whole civic education thing, but I think, you know, we talk about younger voters, but there's so much voter suppression out there. And in Georgia, where there are like 80,000 or more than that taken off voter rolls, and then, you know, you support people like Brett Kavanaugh, who are pro getting, not having as many voters out there. And when you have young people vote, they tend to vote in a certain way, as well as minorities. And I guess my question is, what can be done to change those sentiments?
I can take it.
You can take it?
Sure.
Okay, go ahead. Just let's.
Yeah. Look, voter suppression is a real problem. It's a bigger problem objectively than voter fraud. But I think that what we really need in this country, if we keep learning every election that every vote counts, and therefore it should not be a partisan principle that every vote should be counted. And that's something that's worth the fighting for as well. Ronald Reagan was a big believer in that. He was a big believer in redistricting reform. Which is happening fitfully state by state in this country. If we have more competitive general elections, we'll also have higher election turnout. Part of the problem is you have sort of this rigged system of redistricting, which has made only 35 seats out of 400 competitive generally. And so there's not competitive general elections. You have increasingly one-party cities, one-party states. That rationally turns down a general election turnout. That leads to apathy. So I think election reform is a big piece of what we need to do. And I think it should be done from a nonpartisan perspective. And it should also maybe be even more creative. Fair Vote has an interesting proposal, which was done in Texas and Illinois at one point, where you've got ranked choice, not just ranked choice voting, but representative voting. So in the island of Manhattan, you'd have a Republican go to Congress, in addition to probably three liberals. There are ways we need to be more innovative about increasing representation, about really pushing for election reform in a way that's nonpartisan. And that, frankly, I think if you had nonpartisan redistricting, independent redistricting reform, and open primaries, I think that would go a long way towards healing the polarization of our politics.
Making it easier to vote.
Yes, and lowering barriers to entry rather than erecting them. That's a given. It's not a given in our country. We've got a real problem with voter suppression, but we also see countervailing. I mean, just this election, we saw redistricting reform pass in Michigan, Missouri, and Colorado. We saw same-day registration in Maryland and Nevada. We saw voter ID in Arkansas and North Carolina. This is a larger conversation we need to have as a country. Frankly, the president hasn't been helping. But I do think getting engaged with election reform and encouraging more competitive general elections in cities and states, that would really help civic participation. I think that's part of how we've been lulled into the situation.
Do you want to take a couple of questions and make?
Let's. We can see one there. So yeah, let's start. Yes, we take three questions and then we'll try to answer. And next.
I just want to take sort of a different, diametric opposed view of the first comment, the gentleman, say that Mr. Bobbitt's statements about questioning our history are much more important and are not really represented by some of the statements that are made up here. I would say that, Bret, I came to adulthood at a similar time as you, and I remember things very differently. To only remember Checkpoint Charlie and the demilitarized zone and ignore Pinochet, supported Zia, the fomenting a coup against Mossadegh. All these things are also in our history. And painting us as this country that is exceptional, that has only these beautiful things in our past, is the recipe for complacency and is the recipe for allowing somebody to make his mantra, make America great again, when it was only great. Because when those decisions were made, the good decisions were made, there was a battle and the positive views won, the progressive views won. And for you to also have to apologize for using the term liberal democracy says a lot about your positions, the liberal democracy says a lot about your positions, and I think that it is much more important to question our behavior and ask how we can be different rather than simply state that things are great and they're not great now.
Handle it. Let me handle it. Don't worry. Of course, I'll handle it.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah. It's on the bottom.
Okay.
And this mic.
Let's try again. No. All right. Garry, a simple but important, troubling question, and that is simply the death of truth today. Of objective truth. Pat Moynihan probably said it best. Unlike one of your colleagues to speak to the issue, you're entitled to your own opinion, but it's not your own set of facts.
Yep.
One more is, okay, over there.
Yeah, I'd like to follow the expertise of Mr. Kasparov regarding Crimea. And Putin would say the people there are Russian and they're pleased to be where they are now as opposed to where they were previously. Mr. Kasparov, if there were a true plebiscite, honest plebiscite, today, what do you think that the people would say is regarding their condition?
Okay, I think I can handle three questions. And actually, the answer comes from the second question. It's about death of truth. Because maybe because we were born on different sides, on the other sides of the Iron Curtain, we saw the world differently. I was born in the Soviet Union. And the way we viewed America was very different from the way you viewed America. I didn't divide presidents on progressives or conservatives. I looked at them, and millions of people were born on the other side of the Iron Curtain from their contribution to stop communism and to defeat the most unhuman system in the world and make and set us free. Two of my favorite presidents after World War II, one Democrat, one Republican, Harry S. Truman and Ronald Reagan. One stopped communism expansion, another one destroyed it, communism. By the way, without a single shot. Now, you can, yeah, it's, we don't have time to argue. You mentioned, for instance, the Mossadegh, the coup. By the way, I can spend hours with you to tell that your view is very limited because you don't know all the facts. No, it's just, it's a complicated story. The role that the role that mullahs played in overthrowing him, and the CIA role was actually minuscule. But the most important thing is, if not for Harry Truman taking a strong stand in 1946, there would be no Mossadegh. Iranian mullahs would be teaching Quran in Siberia because half of Iran was occupied by Stalin. And only Harry Truman's, now that's fact. In March 1946, half of Iran had been seized by the Soviet Union. They declared the so-called the Soviet Republic of South Azerbaijan. And if not for demand of the United States, there would be end of Iran. Yeah, so that's a fact. And again, that's just, we're talking about real facts. Yeah, and there are many other cases where, you know, it's not, you know, you can look at the liberal president or conservative president, but at the end of the day, some of them took, you know, there were retrenchments, like during Eisenhower, there were more proactive stand, like for instance, you know, what JFK had to do in 1962. So taking a very strong stand and basically, you know, pushing Soviets out of the Western Hemisphere. Now, moving to the Crimea question, I think, you know, it's a fallacy to actually start using arguments of plebiscite. That's exactly what Adolf Hitler said about Sudets. Yeah, that's why you can justify Anschluss of Austria. Of course, Austrians wanted to join Germany. But are we talking about plebiscites or about the law and the documents, international treaties that have been signed? Now, the uniqueness of Crimea, by the way, even if you try to compare it to Sudet land or Austrian Anschluss or Saddam Hussein occupation of Kuwait, you know what's the difference? Unlike Adolf Hitler, and I'm not here, of course, to defend his record, or Saddam Hussein, just another criminal, Vladimir Putin, or any Russian authority, whether it was Vladimir Putin himself, Dmitry Medvedev, his shadow placeholder, or Boris Yeltsin, or any Russian parliament, since 1991, has not made a single claim for Crimea. That's absolutely, it's unique in history. Saddam Hussein oversaw Kuwait was illegally taken away from Iraq by British colonial powers. Putin never mentioned Crimea. Until the end of 2013, it was not even mentioned. By the way, each Russian president and each Russian parliament eventually ratified agreements that had been signed confirming Ukrainian territorial integrity. That's why all the debates about referendum, yes, you know, it's at the gunpoint, you can have any referendum. So yeah, maybe many Russians would, you know, would vote to join. I don't know. There were 35% of Crimea of citizens of Crimea, Crimean Tatars and Ukrainians that definitely didn't want to go there. By the way, pro-Russian party in Crimea. Ukraine had elections, you know, and still has elections. And unlike Russia, these elections are unpredictable because Ukraine had several presidents who lost elections. That's a fundamental difference between Ukraine and Russia. So the pro-Russian party that argued for annexation of Crimea got 4%. That's a fact. And the man who led the party eventually was nominated the Gauleiter of Crimea, so just using the correct language for that. So when you look at the eastern Ukraine, And you are trying to understand why Vladimir Putin failed to take over 10 Ukrainian regions, as he proclaimed in March, April 2014, 10, from Lugansk to Odessa. And he got only 1.5, maybe less, 60% of two most eastern regions. Most of them are populated by, are just inhabited by Russians, ethnic Russians. But they were not welcoming Russian tanks. Most of them are fighting against Putin's invasion. Objectively, what's happening in eastern Ukraine is not Russian-Ukrainian war, it's a Russian civil war. So those Russians who wanted to live in a free world, they were fighting Vladimir Putin invasion, and those who have been disguised as separatists, but actually it's those who are being funded and equipped by Vladimir Putin. So the problem of Crimea is that the first time since World War II, we had annexation of the territory of neighboring country, and basically the end of the agreements that have been signed since 1945 and guaranteed peace and stability in Europe. And moreover, you know, that's something that people tend to forget. In 1994, Ukraine was forced to relinquish its nuclear arsenal. You know how many nuclear warheads Ukraine had at that time? You don't know. Nearly 2,000. It's more than China, United Kingdom, and France all together. As you get, probably guess that if Ukraine kept even 10% of its arsenal, probably nothing would have happened. But United States and the United Kingdom put all the pressure on Ukraine. By the way, I think it was a good idea, because you better negotiate with one country than having nuclear war had spread across the perimeter of the former Soviet Union. At the same time, they forced Belarus and Kazakhstan that had small nuclear arsenals also to do the same. So it was a rational policy of all nuclear weapons, you know, pushed being allocated in Russia. But Russia also signed guarantees for Ukraine. So the whole deal was exchange of nuclear arsenal, 2,000 warheads, for territorial integrity, signed by Boris Yeltsin, witnessed by Bill Clinton and John Major. So that's a problem that Vladimir Putin has been steadily destroying the pillars of international stability. And that's what happens in these days. And we could see the same here. It's not about just, you know, overturning democracy or international order in overnight. It's just doing it step by step. What happened 3 days ago? They just, you know, seized 3 Ukrainian warships in international waters and arrested 24 Ukrainian sailors, and now they're being charged with crossing Russian frontier. Even if you look at Crimea as Russian territory, which of course is not, still, you know, they were caught in international waters. So what it means that others are watching, China is watching. It is, you know, it's Putin is not just, you know, doing something in Ukraine. He's basically destroying the world order and spreading chaos. And speaking about the facts, Putin, I always call the merchant of doubt. Because unlike Soviet propaganda, he's not spreading ideology that he wants you to buy. He's spreading doubts. We're bad, everybody's bad, democracy is just not as something important. You can no longer find the truth. And by the way, they're quite successful. And that's how they build this fake news industry, because there's so many ways to lie and only one way to tell the truth. And unfortunately, when we look at the response from the free world, It learned too late and it reacted too slow to actually counter these attacks. That's why it's so easy for especially for young minds to be poisoned by this virus of, going back to American history, to know nothing. Yeah. John.
Can I just make one?
We have hit a time limit, so.
John, yes, very quick comment.
I hope we end on what unites us and what values.
Okay,
love the fact that we had so many diverse tonight. I thank you so much for all of them, but I want to hear from you.
Okay. Well, I just want to make a few concluding observations. You know, back in the day when I was more visibly associated with a conservative institution, one of my complaints about the left was that the left had devoted tremendous energies to casting doubt on the greatness of the American constitutional system, because the founders were slaveholders and misogynists and so on. There was a tremendous movement in the progressive academy to actually cast doubt on the concept of truth. What was truth, after all? Truth is in the eye of the beholder. Truth is in the eye of the powerful. Who would defend truth?
There was a tremendous assault on the importance of America as a pillar of international stability and as a force for order in the face of aggressive dictatorships. And by the way, on the left, historically, there was, how can I put it, softness on Russia. Mm-hmm. Now, one of the things that I have to say I love about Donald Trump is that all of a sudden my liberal friends cared deeply about the Constitution, they cared deeply about the importance of truth as opposed to sort of relativism. They are committed to a strong America that isn't kissing up to people like Kim Jong-un, right? And they are nothing but hawks on Russia. I've been waiting for this all of my life. So there's an opportunity here for some real unity. Look, please don't misunderstand me. I said liberal democracy because in every audience someone says, well, what do you mean? I just was trying to be clear. I wasn't trying to denigrate the idea of liberal democracy. But what I really, and I don't want to denigrate either the importance of looking critically at our past without looking at it corrosively. Let us learn from our mistakes, but let us not just pour acid on the whole thing and say this entire country that has given each one of us in this room so much and so many opportunities is no better than a Chinese 21st century dystopia or some other kind of regime. We are an exceptional nation. We are an absolutely exceptional, and how do I know this? Because my mother came to this country as a refugee with $7 to her name, and here I am, a hopeless elite, just a couple of decades later. And I'll just make one final point, and this is to your comment. I am sure, despise my Kavanaugh columns, and that is great. You should, okay? I am not bidding for your agreement when it comes to...
By the way, I also despise it.
That's good. I'm not bidding for your agreement in that sense. What I'm saying is there are questions like, do you like that painting? Do you like the decor? You can say, yes, I like it, or I change it, or whatever. But what we're talking about is the plumbing. We're talking about the structure. We're saying to ourselves, there are things that aren't working here that are not just a matter of I like this, I don't like that, but things that really should unite us, because I think there is an emerging emergency. There are fundamental challenges to the kind of political culture that we, all of us in this room, wherever you are politically, took for granted for a very long time. That political culture is desperately in need of repair. And so that is the work that we're trying to engage in. I think it's exactly the work that Patricia is doing through the Common Good, that we've tried to do through this book and through the Renew Democracy Initiative. And then we're going to have time to have great arguments about the quality of the drapes or the question of how you solve, how you improve voter turnout in that. And I, one of the things, I'll leave it at this. I've always tried to say to myself, Brett, you're right. 80% of the time, you just don't know which 20% is bollocks. And I think we should approach these questions with that sense of a combination of confidence and humility that makes us both skeptics, but proud people who can do something to mend the world in which we live.
Yeah, Patricia, just here, since we have at least one more person, just a few. 2 minutes, just CNN, always has a final word.
The opportunity is, as Brett just said, is that we can find a silver lining out of this civic stress test to retreat from our hyper-partisan corners and the tribalism we've been dripping into and that feedback loop that gets created. Because it is about something bigger than ourselves and bigger than our feelings. It's about the great gift we've been given, no matter when your family came here, and our obligation to hand it to the next generation better. And to not drift into this moral relativism or to fixate endlessly or exclusively on America's faults or imperfections. The point of a diverse liberal democracy is that we are an imperfect people fighting fitfully to form a more perfect union. We never get there. But when we all of a sudden start fixating exclusively on our faults, we create a moral equivalence with other systems that have a far worse track record about human freedom and liberty. And that's something worth keeping an eye on, because there are merchants of doubt trying to blur the lines between fact and fiction. That Moynihan quote is the key quote of our time, I believe. Everyone's entitled to their own opinion, but not their own facts. It just so happens that now we're living in a time where we need to fight for those facts, to redefine that as a basis of common ground. And then we can have a fact-based debate as a country about how we evolve, about how we improve. But we're not going to do it by simply adding more mud to those muddy waters and creating a sense of moral equivalence between liberal democracy and the dictatorships and the demagogues who've always been in the periphery who are increasingly making gains. It's worth fighting for. It's actually a great opportunity for us to unite on that common ground. So anyway, thank you.
Listen to you all evening, but I know everybody has to go off to dinner. I didn't get a chance to acknowledge some of the people in the room. We have members of the press here. And while the press is being attacked, I think it's important to acknowledge the contribution that they give, that's so important. Of course, our journalists up here, but Judith Miller, Nancy Collins, we've got one of the great First Amendment attorneys in the country, Floyd Abrams, our New York former New York Police Commissioner Ray Kelly, and I'm sure. Thank you. Oh, Ed Cox, our Republican chair. So we've got the mix here. This is a chance for people across the spectrum to discuss important ideas, and I hope you give them a lot. This is really one of the most important things you could possibly think about.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, gentlemen. Thank you.